Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath. I have been so blessed to be here. It is really hard to beat New Zealand hospitality. Thank you so much for having me here, the wonderful activities and the food and the memories, and of course the L&P chocolate that I picked up yesterday. My wife specifically told me that I had better bring that home or she was going to lock the door and I wouldn't be allowed to come back in. So she had it the first time we were here and I found it and I'd bring that back along with all the wonderful memories. I want to invite you to stand as we read scripture together for our last message. We talk about Jesus. Not that we haven't been talking about Jesus all week long, but we're really going to look at the story of the Gospels that has blessed me and hope it blesses you. Let's read this together. While he was in one of the cities, there came a man full of leprosy. And when he saw Jesus, he fell on his face and begged him, "Lord, if you are willing, can you be clean?" Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for giving us stories of your life. Thank you so much for being here with us. Thank you so much that no matter what our condition, we can come to you and we can throw ourselves at your mercy, your grace, and your love. You accept us. Jesus, I pray especially for those here today who feel marginalized, maybe feel a little bit dirty, a little bit of soil in their soul, who don't feel that maybe they belong here. I pray that you wrap your arms around them. Holy Spirit, help them to sense your love and acceptance. Help them to know that they have a place in your kingdom and in your family. Jesus, bless us now as we sit together this one last time as a church family at Big Camp. In your precious name we pray. Everyone said, amen. If you have your Bibles, go ahead. Turn to Luke 5, 12, and 16. Turn, tap, scroll, make a friend. You know it from the last couple nights. However you can get there, go ahead and get there. There is a lecture, a very popular lecture, that every single parent gives their child, their young children. I believe it's a lecture that happens everywhere all over the world, in every language. It might be some variations, but the meaning is generally the same. In English, it's a very short lecture. It's a very powerful lecture. And it's one we give to our children before we enter into the store, particularly if that store has expensive items. It's a three-word lecture, and I'm pretty sure you have it here in New Zealand. You can say it with me. Don't touch anything. Don't touch anything. Don't touch anything. I'm serious. You do not touch anything. Don't touch anything. Put your hands in your pockets, behind your back, cut them off. I don't care. Don't touch anything. And it's really good advice. And I wish I would have remembered it shortly after Andrew and I got engaged and went shopping for things for our new home, our future home. We were out in a store called Bombay Company. And I don't know if you have that here. I don't know if it's even a store anymore. But it tends to have higher-end items and trinkets and things. And Andrew was really into this stuff. And I kind of wandered off, which is always dangerous. And I came across this sort of curio cabinet with little trinkets and sculptures. And I was drawn to this perfect little carousel. This little music box. So intricate. Had all these tiny little animals, including a unicorn. I don't know what happened. Maybe it was just the beauty, the craftsmanship. But my right hand was drawn up to that little unicorn, the little horn up there. And I reached up ever so gently. You know, I think it was broken before I touched it. I'm pretty sure, because I barely grazed it. I hardly did anything to it. I touched it, the horn fell right off. I panicked a little bit. We were still in college. You know, if you're a typical college student, you have no money. You're barely, you know, you're surviving on ramen and oxygen and grass and maybe some tap water. It's hard to survive, much less pay for this. I thought maybe this cabinet's in the clearance section or something. Maybe it's cheap. And I turned it over and it said $200, which is like $2,000 to a college student at that time. What am I going to do? I'm a theology major. I just have integrity and be a pastor. And I don't know. I just felt sick about this. So I wandered over trying to figure out what I was going to do, and I found my fiance who was looking at whatever she was looking at, different things for the house. And I said, "Honey," she looked at me and said, "Yes, We need to go. We need to leave right now. We need to get out of the store. It's really important that we go right now. Is something the matter? No, it's fine. Are you sure? Because you look, there's something wrong. No, you know what it is? This world is full of materialism. People are spending money on things that are unnecessary. Do we need any of this? No, we have our love. And that's enough. And let's go. I remember the first time I shared this story, it was at our first church. She was in the front row. Oh, you know, like, so that's why you had to get out of there. I was like, it's too late. I already told Jesus about it and confessed my sins. You can't judge me. It's okay. There are things that we know that we don't touch. And in the ancient world, if there was one thing that you never touched, it was a leper. Everybody knew. Skin deprived, ceremonially unclean, smelly. These creatures haunted the Judean hills, missing fingers and toes and ears and noses and a number of different things. Unwelcome, about as popular as a pedophile. Mangled, gnarled, they look like something out of The Walking Dead. And when we get to the story in Luke chapter 5, one of these horrific looking beings is making its way towards the spotless Lamb of God. Verse 12. While he was in one of the cities, there came a man full of leprosy. Say that word, full. Full. This is not a little rash. It's not just a little blemish. While he was in one of the cities, there came a man full of leprosy. We have to stop the story right there because it's already wrong. It's already completely wrong. There's a flag on the play here. There's a man full of leprosy in the city. That's not supposed to happen. That's not okay. That's violating parole. That's bringing a gun to the airport. That's letting Donald Trump have a Twitter account. That's not okay. These are things that aren't supposed to happen. He's in the city where there's lots of people that could be touched, and he dares to show up. You have to understand something. As a leper, your job was to stay away from people. You were supposed to have nothing to do with society. Lepers had a little lecture too. It was even shorter than the one we just talked about. They had a one-word lecture, a one-word speech they had to give everybody. You know what it is? Unclean. You've heard the phrase before, sometimes used of children. The children are supposed to be what? Seen and not heard. Well, a leper is supposed to be heard but never seen. Ever. Your sole purpose in life was to have no contact with people. No smiling, no waving, no handshakes, no hugs, no kisses, no pats on the back, nothing. Absolutely nothing. He has defined cultural, religious norms by being in that city. You know, sometimes I wonder how much of our church subculture keeps people away. Can you imagine how the disciples must have freaked out about this, by the way? These are the same disciples who flipped out when little kids wanted to come talk to Jesus. And now here comes a leper. This nameless, faceless man walks down streets where he once had a name, where he once had an identity, where he was known by people. I've often wondered, as he was walking through town, did he pass people that he used to know? Did he pass relatives, or parents, or old girlfriends, classmates, teachers from his elementary days? Do people even recognize him anymore? What was he before leprosy? Was he the star athlete? Was he the local academic? Was he voted most likely to succeed? Because now he's most likely to die alone. Did anybody have any idea who he is? No one's smiling at him. No one's cheering that he's there. Kids are screaming. Women are probably screaming. Men are glaring at him and giving him dirty looks and gritting their teeth. He has to pass by religious leaders who I am sure are unhappy with his presence in the city. He has to walk past all of these people to get to Jesus. All of these people who do not want him there, who have made it very clear in their laws and in their culture that a leper is on the outside, not on the inside. You know, sometimes to get healing, And sometimes to get to Jesus, you have to walk past religious people who think that you have no right to approach Jesus in the first place. A couple years ago, a friend of mine I went to church school with, elementary school, posted on Facebook, 11 months sober. And we cheered, we were proud of him. He had been in a place where he picked jobs based on whether or not they were part of a drug test. He had lived his life in a way where he had developed addictions and substance abuse. But in that moment, in that season, a couple years ago, he had given his heart to Christ and he had joined AA and he was 11 months sober. That's a hard thing to do, by the way. Those of you who know what addictions you've seen in your families. But here's the thing, do you know how hard that is in your mid-30s to post something like that? When you're looking out at Facebook, at all your peers, and all the people you went to school with, and they're getting married, and they're having kids, and they're buying houses, and new cars, and taking trips, and graduating from college or graduate school, and you just didn't get drunk today. That's a hard thing. Sometimes you get healing, and it's going to hurt first. Healing is sometimes an incredibly painful process. And you can hear the pain in the leper's words. And when he saw Jesus, he fell on his face and he begged him, "Lord, if you will, if you are willing," some translations say, "if you're able, you can make me well." There's an important communication principle when we have dialogue with each other. It's called subtext. And if you're not aware of subtext, your life is going to be a disaster. We have an example of subtext when we were growing up. "Can you clean your room?" "I can't. Am I going to?" Okay, you missed the subtext there. That's not a question. Somebody needs to take out the trash. Well, I hope you find somebody. There's an implication there. You understand what I'm saying? Sometimes we use the royal "we." We need to pack the kids' lunches to get ready for school. And by "we," you mean me. You understand what I mean by subtext. We're very precarious sometimes, especially in a marriage. Remember a couple years ago, I got a royalty check from Pacific Press. February is royalty month, and people have managed to buy your books. They've taken pity on you, and feel bad, so they buy your books, and you get a little check, and you'll get rich being an Adventist author, but it helps take the edge off a few of the regular expenses. I remember I got this check in the mail, I was looking at it, and wow, this is so helpful. And Angela appeared, my wife, right next to me, and she goes, "Oh, wow, that's really nice. What are you going to spend it on?" And it's a dangerous, dangerous situation, my friend. There is a lot of subtext. I can't say video games. I can't just say I'm going to go to KFC with it and eat out for the next 3 months. I can't do that either. But because I am a master of communication, and I had been married long enough to have some sense, I said, "What do you want to spend it on?" I lived to write another day. What this leper is stating in this moment, it's not a question of whether Jesus is powerful enough to heal him. It has nothing to do with his power. It has nothing to do with any of that. The subtext to this statement is, "Jesus, are you willing to heal me? Or am I too sick, too gross, too disgusting for God to have anything to do with? Am I too far gone? Is it too late for me? Has this disease, has this sickness ravaged me so much that there is nothing left of me worth saving?" Behind every question, there is a drama. Behind every statement like that, there is a whole lot of things behind it. Am I too sick for Jesus to heal? And too often, the church's reply has been, "Yes." When I was at Union College, I took a year off, about 8 months off into my freshman year, to become a task force worker student missionary in Newfoundland, Canada, which is sort of the backwoods part of Canada. When my Canadian friends found out I was going there, they told me, "Don't judge Canada all of Canada once you see in Newfoundland. Just please know that there's a whole other part of the continent there. But I had a good time, made a lot of good memories. And one of my classmates was with me, my friend named Jose. Jose was Creole. He lived in Florida and had really never been out into the woods. But he was a very joyful soul. Loved Jose, and I remember he had never really, his experience with camping was nil. There was nothing. And so we went to the summer camp, and we were sort of the camp, summer camp chaplains out there. And I remember going in his little cabin, and on his dresser, all kinds of lotions, and all kinds of oils, and all kinds of colognes. I thought, oh man, you have no idea what's happening during this week of camping in the woods. Now, one memory I have specifically that always brings me joy, I think I was sharing this with a couple people earlier this week, is at that particular camp at that time, they've revamped it now, it's lovely. But there was an outhouse that I believed could have been a portal to the underworld. Now, that conflicts with my theology. I believe when you die, you rest until Jesus comes and gives you immortality. But if my theological framework was different, I would promise you that place was the way to Hades. That place was evil. You would smell it before you saw it. He'd been there 60, 70 years and not replaced. If we hated you, you had to want to go to the bathroom real bad. You have to go real bad to go in there. You have to use the buddy system. Like, if I don't come out in 10 minutes, you gotta send somebody after me. You gotta tie like a rope with some bells on my feet. And if they stop jangling whatever, you need to pull me out of there and revive me. And so I remember one night we were in our cabins, and he made the comment, I gotta go to the bathroom. Stopping yet. Do what you gotta do. And he's like, oh, I wanna go there. And you know, it's just number one. I gotta go and I just don't do it. I was like, that was a dream. Remember, he's never been getting what? You get out of here. I'm like, oh my goodness, you. And so I just spent the next 5 minutes explaining the mechanics behind this, right? This is how this works, you know. And he's like, I don't know about that. I'm gonna think about it. Back to reading my book or my Bible, whatever I was reading. And then a few minutes later, I'm going to do it. Okay, good luck, man. I believe in you. And so he left. And about 30 seconds later, he comes back, and I did it. Like, man, it takes 30 seconds to get to the tree. You didn't do anything. Like, there's no way. But this is one of the funny memories I have from him. We told stories to the kids. And when he did worships, the one thing I remember, he was a dynamic. He had the black preaching dynamic, just passionate and just full of fire, and content was so good. And he was just an amazing speaker, and he exuded joy, and just tell he loved Jesus. Wonderful man of God. We got back from our student missions experience, and we finished school, and I got a call. He didn't get a call right away. I ran into him a couple of years later, and he became a local restaurant, still full of joy, still full of Jesus, saying, I'm waiting for my call, I know it's going to come, and I'll, in the meantime, serve at the local church. And we lost touch for a while. But all of my memories of Jose were good. It made me laugh, it made me smile. So you can imagine how shocking it was when I got the news just before I graduated from seminary that Jose had shot himself. After he had shot his wife. When you get news like that, your brain, there's nothing, you just shut down. I remember sitting on the stoop in our little duplex, not even able to know, I didn't know what to think, I didn't know, nothing to say. Apparently they had been fighting for quite some time. People knew about it, but nobody bothered to do anything. And one night, in the heat of an argument, he lost control and killed his wife. And then he came to his senses and he realized what he had done. And by the way, he had been working as an evangelist and a Bible worker in Florida. He was sharing the gospel with people, even though his own personal life was being ripped apart. And when he came to his senses and realized what he had done, he felt that the only way out was to take his own life. His body washed up on the shore. He did it on a bridge. The story gets worse. So much worse. The local Adventist church that he had been serving in refused to have the funeral. that because a friend of mine did the service right before he left the Adventist Church. It's one of the many reasons he had. But in this moment where the body of Christ could have reached out to a family that has unimaginable grief and agony, they could have done something. They could have been a light. They could have spoken into that situation and rallied around the community and the grieving family and wept with them and cried with them, but instead they couldn't be mine. So often, we are more concerned about our own reputation than somebody else's salvation. We become the very people we are trying to avoid by avoiding the very people Jesus calls us to minister to. Matthew 25:41-46. Jesus is talking about what things are going to be like when he comes back. And he's addressing a particular group of people. People who believe that they have been doing the right thing and they've been upholding the truth. And here's what Jesus says. He'll say to those on his left, "Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, you gave me no food. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, you didn't welcome me. Naked, you didn't clothe me. Sick and in prison, I was a thief. I was a murderer, I was a mess. Visited me. He never ministered to me." Then he will answer them saying, "Truly I say to you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it for me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." Jesus looks at people who pass by other people who are hungry and present, thirsty, and claims that if we are unwilling to know them and to interact with them, then he will have nothing to do with us because Jesus so closely identifies with suffering. So we continue our story in Luke chapter 5. And Jesus stretched out his hand. This is important. We're dealing with Jesus here. Jesus could have chosen a multitude of methods to heal this man. I mean, seriously, he could have done anything. He knew that leper was coming. Jesus is God. He's divine. We believe that as Seventh-day Adventist Christians. He knew he was coming. What he could have done is, "Oh, it's a leper. This is a job for one of my interns. Hey, Judas, you should go over there. I know what you're going to do anyway. It's a good time. You know, go and touch that leper. Get over there." He doesn't do that. He could have treated him like Naaman. Jesus would have been familiar with the story of Naaman, right? He said, look, don't touch me. Don't breathe on me. You're sick. What you can do is go to the Jordan River, dip 7 times, and it'll be fine. Just do it that way. He could have done a long distance healing. "Oh, I see him coming. Just be healed. Oh, gross." He could have given some health literature to his disciples. "Look, just tell him what to do." He could have turned on 3ABN or Hope Channel. He could have done a number of different things to avoid contact. Because after all, we see people like this. They're not people, they're problems. And they're contagious. We don't want to have anything to do with them. But Jesus picks the most personal, intimate way he could have to heal a leper. And Jesus stretched out his hand and what? Touched him. I personally believe that even if no healing had taken place, physical healing, there would have been a spiritual healing just because Jesus touched him. Remember, what is the one thing that a leper cannot have? It's touch. That's the one thing. I mean, you imagine it. I mean, there's been so many studies in social science and behavioral science. What happens when people they're not hugged and they're not touched? It absolutely shrivels people's souls. You need touch. You need contact. Imagine living a week or 3 weeks, or months, or years, but not even so much as a handshake or a fist bump. No hugs, no kisses, nothing. If there was one thing that this person would have desperately wanted, it was someone touch me. I am still a human being. I am still here. And Jesus touches him. By the way, you know how leprosy works? Leprosy is a disease that robs you of your ability to feel. which is why people have accidents. They can't feel. The pain sensors are gone. All those nerve endings are shot, and so they burn themselves and they hurt themselves. They can't feel anymore. So Jesus knows us so well. The perfect Son of God puts his perfect hand on that broken body. And in that moment, I have to believe that the tears are running down that leper's face. I'm still here. I'm still human. God hasn't forgotten about me. And immediately, the leprosy left him. Praise the Lord. And he charged him, tell no one, but go and show yourself to the priest. And this is such a smooth move on Jesus' part, because it would have been the priest that would have initially inspected him and rejected him from society. Based on old Levitical laws, when a person has on the skin of a body a swelling or an eruption or a spot, and it turns into a case of leprous disease on the skin of his body, then he should be brought to Aaron the priest, or to one of his sons the priest, and the priest shall examine the diseased area of the skin of his body and determine how to treat it, whether to treat it, let them be a part of the society, or let them go. So Jesus works within those religious channels to vindicate this man's boldness and his faith. Go show yourselves to the priests. Go show yourselves to those religious leaders. So all these different groups can see, including the Pharisees. And the Pharisees, the name Pharisee means separatist. These are people all about separating, whether it was a church, whether it had to do with what you're eating, all about separate. Jesus works through those channels to restore this man and give him a powerful testimony that is still changing lives thousands of years later after it happened. There are people who are still experiencing a healing touch from Jesus because of what Jesus did to this leper. See, Jesus accepts the unacceptable, and he transforms them into something exceptional. And this message still has power to influence our practice, to influence how we want to go about reaping the harvest. One semester at Union College, I taught a section of Christian beliefs. And I had a different variety of students with different faith backgrounds in there. And one of the students, as we were doing a lecture about church and church life, and I don't know how we got on the topic, but we talked about discipline, church discipline, censuring and disfellowshipping in the context of redemption. We touched on this a little bit earlier this week. Church discipline is not about punishing people. It's about boundaries. It's about letting people experience the consequences of their own actions, not some vindictive type of thing you're supposed to do. When something gets really toxic or abusive, sometimes you need to set up boundaries in your relationships. And it's sad, and it's painful, and it's messy, but sometimes in some extreme cases you have to. And I can't remember how it came up in the lecture. We were just talking about different things and boundaries and experience with the church, and she raised her hand. She said, I have a huge problem with this. She said, when I was 16, I got pregnant. Not on purpose. Just a oops. Just happened. Caught up in the moment. Weren't careful. And now, you may know somebody who's had a teenage pregnancy. You may have, as a parent, you tend to think worst case scenarios. What has ever happened to my daughter? What has ever happened to my granddaughter? Those of you who have any contact with youth or teenagers, you think about a 16-year-old girl, how scary that is. Your entire life is now going to be completely different. Whether you choose to keep the baby, get the baby up for adoption, or have an abortion, whatever path you choose, it's going to be a very difficult emotional path for you. And so this teenage girl, she said, I was scared. I didn't know what to do. I was confused. I was full of fear. And so I went to my church. She grew up in a very conservative Lutheran church, probably Missouri Synod. Don't know that for sure, but they tend to be the most conservative. A lot of fine people in there, in that church, but this particular church that she was talking about. So I went there. I said, I need help. And I'm scared. And I'm confused. And they disfellowshipped her. 16-year-old girl. And she told me in the class that day, for everyone to hear, I have never set foot in the church ever again. Now contrast that with an experience we had at my church in Puyallup just a couple of years ago. But the same thing happened. Lovely teenage girl, late teens, early 20s, got pregnant. Not meaning to, caught up in the moment, it happened. And she even recognized, she told us this was not right, this is not God's will, this is not how this is supposed to go. And she came to our church. And you know what people did? You know what people gave her? A baby shower. They didn't give her criticism, they gave her diapers. They gave her formula and clothes and cake and hugs and tears. And I remember going to that baby shower that was put on by my elders. I didn't even have to ask them to do it. They just knew to do that. I remember just seeing her in tears, in disbelief that a church family would rally around her that way and support her and love her. And she came back and gave a testimony. We have to dedicate that baby, by the way. And she came back and gave a testimony. And she said, I know that this was wrong. This was not what God wanted for me. But I am so grateful for a church family that loves me anyway. That supports me anyway, that rallies around me. And she's still pursuing her medical career as a doctor. She goes on mission trips, and she has her baby boy. And she has her church family. And she's still in God's family. Because we know that when things happen in every single one of our lives, there are things that are unacceptable, there are things that are broken, there are things that are sinful. But the best response is to embrace people, not avoid them, to touch them, to hold them close, to pray with them and love them, because that has a transforming power on their life. Jesus describes his mission in the previous chapter, what he came to do. He goes to church and preaches this sermon. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That is his mission. That is what he came here to do, to find the broken and the imprisoned and the oppressed and the people who have leprosy of the soul, who deal with sins of every imaginable kind, and say, I came here specifically for you. Sometimes we think, because I have sinned and I have messed up and I keep making the same mistakes and I have these struggles, that I am no longer worthy of Jesus' love and grace. That is the same lie, according to Ellen White in the book Great Controversy, that the devil told the angels right after they rebelled. It's too late for you. It's too late. Just fall with me. And they did. It is not too late. It is not too late for you. It doesn't matter what you've done. As a matter of fact, your brokenness, your sinfulness, your mess, whatever form of leprosy you have, whether it's a physical leprosy or a spiritual leprosy or an emotional leprosy, that qualifies you for Jesus' ministry. You're exactly who he's looking for. Now, for those of us who have no sin, the liars, according to Jesus' brother James, say there is no sin in us. Even if no sin, the light is not in us. This message is for you too. You need it just as much. But even if you're in a season of life when things are mostly working, when things are going pretty good, things are pretty balanced, things are pretty peaceful, guess what? You have the same mission of Jesus. To go and find those people who are hurting and broken and terrified and fearful, and to find them and let them know that no matter what is going on, they are still loved by God. They are still loved by his church. And as messy as it can be, we will find a place for you. And we will pray with you, and we will hug you, and we will cry with you. We will touch your life. We are committed to this because we see Jesus' example. We know how he feels about it. So my challenge to you in this last message is to follow the example of Jesus, to embrace and touch the unacceptable in order to transform them and to love them into something exceptional. Dear Jesus, again, thank you for these stories in the Gospels, these chronicles of your life that give us hope. Jesus, I want to pray for the lepers out there. Maybe we don't have physical leprosy, but we feel it in our hearts or in our minds, in the patterns of our life. We feel like we're on the outside, that we are unclean and unworthy of your love. And in some ways that might be true, but your love is so powerful that it reaches out to those of us who are broken. You intentionally seek us out because you love us so much and you put so much value on us. And you want us to show us, you want to show us a better way. You want us to experience healing. So for those who feel on the outside looking in, Spirit, move their hearts towards you. Help them to know that, they are on the inside with you. They are in your family, in your kingdom. Help them to just throw themselves on your mercy and love. You've been waiting for that. So they are not outcasts, that they're not undesirable, that you died for them. You have so much more you want to do through them and with their life. Jesus, help us to rest assured in that love, in that grace, and touch each and every person here in a deeply personal way. Spirit, communicate things through thoughts or just feelings, whatever we need to have right now in this moment. However you need to do it, let you do it now. Help us to receive it and rejoice in it. We give you the glory.